Hi, this is the second episode concerning the Bendix AirData computer. Today we will see the MAC module. This is the MAC number module. So I did the reverse engineering of that electromechanical module and also the reverse engineering of several electronic boards. First, let's see the electromechanical section of that module. The servo motor is here. There is a motor and the generator attached to this motor. The servo control amplifier is here. The output is connected to the drive winding of the motor. The reference winding is connected to the power supply, 115 volts. The generator is connected to a second input of the servo control amplifier. So this permits the control of the velocity of the motor. The shaft of the motor is here. There is a gear train. There is a torque limiter here using a friction coupler. There is a device here which limits the rotation to 8 turns. So we can see this 8 turns limiter. We can see that the rotation of the motor is fed to two different things. First, the rotation is fed to one input of this differential. And also, the rotation of the motor permits to rotate the output shaft, which is this shaft here. There is here a control transformer with a clutch. I don't know exactly at that time what is the purpose of this control transformer. And there is here also a kind of clutch. So this permits to engage this gear in one turn. And there is also a one turn limiter. This limiter is required because of the cam which is here. Okay, so the motor is linked to the output shaft and to this cam. The output of the cam is fed also to the second input of the differential. The output of the differential here is fed to a control transformer. And there is another gear train here which permits to drive a second control transformer, which is this one. On the wiper, there is a part of the error voltage, because there is a second part, which is provided by the secondary of this transformer. Okay, so the error voltage is present here. So when this system is locked, the sum of this voltage and this one is zero. So I guess that this voltage should be an image of the static pressure, and the voltage here should be an image of the impact pressure. In that case, when the system is stabilized, we have the static pressure multiplied by the Mach number minus the impact pressure equals zero. That means that the Mach number equals the impact pressure divided by the static pressure. And there is a function which is provided by this cam also. So this is, in my opinion, how this thing works. But for the moment, I don't know where the stator of this control transformer is connected. I don't know also the purpose of this one. What is interesting is the output shaft, which is here. We can see that the output shaft is linked to one synchro transmitter. The stator of this synchro transmitter is connected to three pins of one connector. So this is obviously the output of the Mach number. The reference winding of this synchro is connected directly to the power supply, 115 volts, which is the reference. Also, there are these three potentiometers. So one is used for the static source error correction. This is this potentiometer here. And there are also two other potentiometers I didn't see the first time. We can see the connections. Here, these two potentiometers. One is used for the static air temperature. The second one is used for the true air speed. Let's have a look on the static source error correction. I have done a measurement of the resistances between each point of this potentiometer. So you can see here the resistances. So this is interesting, because you can see that we have, for example, two resistances of 1K70 approximately. If you suppose that the potentiometer is linear, and if you suppose that 1K7 corresponds to Mach 0.1, so you can calculate the equivalent Mach number for each point, and you find the values in red from Mac 0.15 okay, to Mac 0.8, the difference is 0.1 approximately between every point, and after Mac 0.8 there is a variation of 0.025, and the maximum is Mac 0.92. This is something I have already encountered in the Collins 590 AirData computer. This is used for the static source error correction because the static port actually is not totally static. There is of course the static pressure, but there is also a small amount of dynamic pressure which enters the static port. Depending on the aircraft, for a given Mach number, you need to subtract or to add a given amount of altitude. So let's have a look on the documentation of the Collins 590. We can see on the screen the correction required for the fanjet Falcon. We can see that we find here the same Mach numbers than the Mach numbers I have calculated on the various taps of the potentiometer. You can see that they are absolutely identical up to 0.92, and we can see on that column the correction to be applied, so it can be positive or negative, it depends on the aircraft. We can check another aircraft, for example, this is the Gulfstream 2, so we can see that the values are different. So depending on the aircraft, you need to add or to subtract a given altitude in feet here, depending on the Mach number, so this should be programmable. You can see on the screen the schematic diagram of the Collins 590, but it seems absolutely identical to this unit. So we can see here the SSEC potentiometer with the various taps. The output here is fed to the altitude module in order to compensate the altitude. On each intermediate tap, there is a transformer which delivers a specific voltage relative to ground. There is one transformer for each tap. The primary of all transformers are available on one connector of that device, and there are also various voltages. The goal is to connect all primaries to a specific voltage which depends on the altitude to be corrected. So there is a relation between the AC voltage here and the altitude. On the screen, we have the schematic of the servo control amplifier. This one, so there are four identical servo control amplifiers on that system, one for each module. This part is actually a dual op-amp. The input of the amplifier is here, so there are two inputs actually. This permits to have also a control of the velocity using the second input here. So we can see on the right the output stage. In the middle, there is an interesting circuit, so we can see that we have two JFETs. This one is a P-channel JFET. This is the voltage follower. The AC voltage on the source here is identical to the AC voltage on the gate. We can see a capacitor, and we can see another JFET which is used as a switch, obviously. The drive of this switch comes from the output of this op-amp which is used as a comparator. There is one input here. The input voltage is amplified with a gain which depends on the ratio between these two resistors. It is approximately 12 or something like that. So we can see that if the output voltage is above a given threshold, which is small because it is the threshold of this diode plus a polarization which is performed by this resistor, there is a current flowing here. So in that case, the output voltage is negative, close to the minus power supply. So in that case, if this voltage is positive, this diode is off. That means that the non-inverting input is at 0 volt approximately. And if the voltage is negative in off, below a given threshold also, the output voltage will be also at a negative level of minus 10 also. So most of the time, the output voltage is negative, and therefore this JFET is off. And when the output voltage is close to zero, in that case, there will be a positive pulse at the output here. And this positive pulse turns on this transistor. So this is actually a sample and hold. This permits to convert the sine error voltage, which is present at the output of this amplifier, to a square wave. So this has two advantages. So first, this permits to decrease the noise when the signal is small, and this permits also to have a phase shift of 90 degrees, which is required by the AC motor. The input here is connected to the power supply. I guess that on the power supply there is an RC network which permits to give this 90 degrees phase shift. So there is maybe an integrator or differentiator using an op-amp, I don't know. So this is a nice circuit. On the screen we have the reverse engineering of one very important board, which is this one. This board is actually the static air temperature and true air speed board. There are two dual op-amps on that board, these two parts here. The pinout is on the right here, it is a very strange pinout. I have already encountered this pinout in one instrument, but I don't remember which one. This board is connected to two pins of one connector. These pins are these two large pins here, this one and this one. These pins are actually connected to the total air temperature sensor, which is here. So normally it is the Platinum PT500. You can see that this probe is supplied using these two resistors, this one and this one in series. So you can see that this pin is connected to this part of the power supply module. So it uses an LM100, which is regulator. I have calculated a nominal voltage of 20 volts at the output here. But I didn't find anything connected to this pin. It is strange. It seems obvious that this pin should be connected to that point, but there is something wrong. So I will check next time if there is something wrong. There is maybe a relay or something in between. This signal, which should be a reference voltage, is connected to the MAC module, to one pin, and there is a short circuit with another pin. But I didn't find anything neither connected to this pin, so I think we should have a connection between this pin and this one. So if it is the case, if we suppose that there is a reference voltage, there is another reference voltage at the output of this buffer, this is a voltage follower, and this permits to supply a current to the sensor. And at this point, we should have the square root of the total air temperature in Kelvin. It is something which is classic. If you have a vintage hard attack computer, you will always find such a circuit. You have a resistor in series with the sensor, and you have another resistor, this one here, connected between this point and the positive power supply. And the square root of the total air temperature is available on that point. I did a simulation in one of my previous videos, I don't remember which one. And effectively, this voltage is very close to the square root of the temperature. We can have a look also on the circuit which is used on the Collins 590. Okay, we can see the circuit of the Collins. We can see that there is a power supply of 20 volts. There is a resistance here of 3.3 kilo ohms approximately, and another one of 330 ohms connected in series with a temperature probe, which is connected to the ground also. This point is connected to a voltage follower, and we have at the output here the square root of the total air temperature. So this is a simple method which was used in the past in order to compute directly the square root of the total air temperature. The function uses the nonlinearity of the Platinum sensor associated to these particular values, but you can use probably another pair of resistors. It is what we have in the Bendix computer, but I think this provides the same effect. And I have found this pair of resistors in several air data computers. Okay, so the voltage here, which is an image of the square root of the total air temperature, is fed to this JFET. So we can see that we have two complementary JFETs. So this is actually a multiplexer. We have two inputs, this one, and one output. So the second input here is connected to this voltage divider. This is a constant voltage, I guess. So I guess that this line is used for the self-test. When the self-test is activated, a constant voltage is fed to that circuit in order to simulate a given temperature, otherwise the input of this amplifier is connected to that point, which is the temperature measurement. So this is an amplifier with a gain of 3 approximately, and at the output we should have the square root of the total air temperature. This voltage is fed to two potentiometers. There are these two potentiometers here, this one and this one. Okay, so they are linked, of course, to the Mach number. We can see that we have two buffers. This one is an amplifier with a gain which is very close to 1, and this one is a voltage follower. The output of each amplifier is connected to one pin of the connector. Obviously, one is used for the static air temperature. I don't know which one, and the second one is used for the true air speed. So these potentiometers are not classic potentiometers. Actually, these two potentiometers should have also intermediate taps, and some resistors should be connected inside the potentiometer in order to have a specific function. So we can see that for the static air temperature, the value should decrease when the Mach number increases, but it is something different for the true air speed. The true air speed increases when the Mach number increases. So we have two different functions. One is decreasing, the second one is increasing with the Mach number. This is why the connections of these two potentiometers are crossed actually. Okay, we can see here this point one is connected to pin 3 of the second one, and pin 3 of this one is connected to pin 1. It is something which is used also on the Collins 590. We can see on the screen an extract of the documentation of the Collins 590. So we can see here, it is written, the Mach follow-up potentiometer is a 5-deck unit that includes the functions for computing static air temperature and true air speed. Okay, so I think we have something equivalent, but we don't have a 5-deck unit, but a 3-deck unit. But I think effectively it performs the same function, so we have embedded functions inside the potentiometer. That's all for today. Thank you for watching and see you next time. Bye bye.